All right, so I have a pretty data-intensive presentation for you, so I'm going to go through some PowerPoint presentation slides with you. Typically, I wouldn't do that. I would walk around and talk to you a little bit more, but I'm going to throw a lot of numbers at you today, so I want you to be able to see the visualization behind that rather than me just throwing those numbers at you and expecting you to understand what I'm saying. So let's go ahead and get started. In order for you to understand what the job market looks like, I think it's probably a good idea to understand what the communication field looks like as far as students. So just to give you a little idea about how many students we have out there right now, we have 802 undergraduate programs. We maybe a little more, maybe a little bit less, but that's what we can actually find, 802 undergraduate programs. There's no real way to know how many students we have in those programs. That's a lot of programs to go through. Obviously, we have 256 graduate communication programs, and that includes both master's and PhD programs. And you can see how that breaks down. So total graduate enrollment, first-time graduate enrollment, and graduate degrees awarded. And primarily, those are awarded to female students. So we have a very large female workforce in communication, at least potential female workforce in communication, and quite a few that were graduating, 609 doctoral students in 14-15 and over 7,000 master's students that year. So a good, healthy population. But alone, these numbers don't mean a lot, right? If I just tell you this is how many people we have, that's great. But that doesn't tell you a whole lot about what the industry looks like for their job opportunities. So let's look at that a little bit closer. So if you look at the number of advertisements for academic positions in communication, these are for doctoral degrees. So if you look, it's very clear that in 2009, we had 351 job advertisements for doctoral students who were graduating that year. That's been steadily increasing every year until 2015, we had 802. So we'll get new data this year. We look at that every year, put out a new jobs report every year on our website on natcom.org. So you can look at that each, usually around the middle of each year, we produce a new one. So in the last one, we had 802 graduates or 802 job advertisements. But again, not gonna tell you a whole lot, right? So if you look at how many advertisements we had compared to how many students we were graduating, then you start to see what the academic job market actually looks like. So you can see here that in 2009, we had way more people graduating, PhD conferred, than we had job advertisements, okay? Does anybody know what was going on in 2009 that may have impacted that? You remember it was not the best economic situation at that time. But we started to move out of that every year since then. And then if you move over to 2012, you can see that it flip-flops. So every year since then, we've had more advertisements, more position advertisements than we had PhDs conferred. Now, does that mean that every single PhD got a job? I don't know that. But it does mean that what we have are enough jobs for the market that we're producing. So we're not overproducing PhDs without position opportunities for them. So comparatively, it looks like we're doing pretty good. If you look at how communication stacks up to other similar disciplines like sociology, history, philosophy, and English, we're doing really well. We've got a steady trajectory here of jobs available to our communication students. Sociology hasn't been able to provide the last couple of years' data, but they've been pretty steady at this. English produces a lot of job advertisements, but a lot of those are contingent jobs. And then they've had a steady decline over the past couple of years. So we look to be in a very healthy job situation for the people that we are graduating with doctoral degrees. One of the things that we're interested in the national office is figuring out where our PhD students are going. We would like to kind of see where they're moving once they graduate, if they're going into academic careers, how they're progressing in their academic careers, if they are looking at alt academic careers, what it is that they're doing, if they're getting tenure, if they're not getting tenure, if they're choosing to leave the university before tenure. So we started to look at that a little bit, but in order to just get an idea of what was going on, we wanted to look at a small sample before we took on a larger project. So I looked at the participants in the Doctoral Honor Seminar. If you're familiar with the Doctoral Honor Seminar, it's a yearly seminar for doctoral students. There's usually about 30 that gather at a university over the summer and engage in a weekend of intensive research work. So I was a doctoral honors scholar back in maybe 2008, 2009, I don't know. But we started looking at this data from 2008 forward. And so we had 209 participants that covered 64 PhD programs, which is a good breadth of those PhD programs because that covers almost all of our PhD programs. Of the ones that we looked at, a good portion of those, a fourth of them, were still students, so we can't really figure out what a lot of them are doing right now. But most of them hold the traditional positions that you would expect a PhD to go on and hold. So assistant professors, associate professors, most of them have not had the opportunity to move into the associate professor level, and none of them have had the opportunity to move on to full professorships. So we had none of those and very few assistants or associates. Lots of assistants and several that were contingent faculty. Now the reason that we had some that were contingent faculty is because we also had a lot that had chosen to go into alt academic careers. And so they were choosing alt academic careers and they were adjuncts. So they were doing two things at one time. They were choosing to stay in the discipline in some way, but they were choosing to do something else with their degree, which we're seeing more and more people talk about. If you've noticed over the past couple of conventions, we've had more programming that has looked at what you can do with a PhD that's not academic, that's maybe academic but not in the university. So we're seeing more people who are interested in finding out what they can do with their PhD that's not in the university. So some of the places that they were working, Samsung, NIH, CDC, the Corps of Engineers, different medical facilities, community centers, and they're working at, and they're working in really high-level jobs. They're research directors, they're data scientists, they're ad managers, they're running big campaigns in Senate offices. So they're not doing menial tasks. They've gone out and they've taken on big roles in industry. So alt academic careers are getting more and more popular as we move forward. All right, so switching over now to undergraduates a little bit. We don't have a lot of hard data like we do for graduate students on what undergraduates do with their careers because there's a huge amount of undergraduates to track. But we do know how important it is to have a communication degree for undergraduates. So there's a lot of research, a lot of reports that employers provide that tell us how important a communication degree is for the undergraduate to have, or how important it is to have communication skills. So if you look at these things right here, this list of learning outcomes, these are all learning outcomes that were rated at 8, 9, or 10 by employers on a scale of 0 to 10. So all of these are things that we teach in communication classrooms. So you can see how important communication is to an undergraduate who's looking for a job. Employers want these things from our communication students. Along with that, these are hiring intentions for 7 categories. So if you look at communication and media studies, and then some of that would probably fall into arts, humanities, and liberal sciences. A lot of places don't separate those two, so we can't always pull those out. But in this survey, they had numbers of employees, numbers of hires on average in 2015-16, and then the percents change. So communication and media studies is seeing an increase in the amount of jobs that are offered over the year, as are arts, humanities, and liberal sciences. Everybody make sense of that? That make clear? Okay. All right, so everybody wants to know when they're in school, I want a job, that's why I'm here, but I also want to know how much money I'm going to make. So I had a student tell me that she was going to major in PR and she was going to graduate and she was going to make $75,000 in this little rural town in Indiana. We had to have a real talk about the truth of that. And she was just blown away. So students have their ideas about what's going to happen when they go out on the job market when they're undergraduates, but so do PhDs. So we have some salary data that I think is interesting. The median average wage of a person who graduates with an undergraduate communication degree can expect to make around $54,000. That is currently. The newest data indicates that there's a top type of job and the lower type of job. These are mid-range salaries. So if you're looking at a chief marketing officer, their mid-range salary is going to be $187,000. Reporters are going to be looking at around $43,000. So to me, if you're looking at $187,000 and that's your mid-range salary, you're going to do pretty good in life. And depending on where you live, I guess reporters would do just the same. Changes a little bit when you look at professors. Again, we get much harder data on what we do with our PhD students. So we can provide a lot more information on what the salaries look like for people who have PhDs who go out into the academic job market. So you can see over the next few slides what it looks like for professors, associates, assistants, and instructors who go on to work in the institution, what they can expect to make on average while in the institution. So you can see that communication for the professor, so for a full professor, they're doing pretty good. They're right next to philosophy, higher than English, higher than history, a little bit lower than social sciences. Again, sometimes we're lumped in with social sciences, so there might be a little bit of overlap there. Associates, again, you're looking at about the same thing. These stay pretty similar all the way through. Communication and philosophy are going to look similar. Social sciences are going to be a little bit higher. The assistant professors, it breaks it out into assistant professors and new assistant professors. I didn't put new assistant professor information up here because it really doesn't change. It's going to change, if at all, by a couple of $100s. So it looks about the same that this does. So new assistant professors can expect to make about the same as this on average. So again, these are averages. And then instructor salaries across the board. You can see that history is a little bit lower here. Philosophy jumps a little bit higher than communication here. And English goes down. And the gap between communication and social science closes just a bit. So instructors in communication seem to be doing quite well on the average as far as what's reported here. Now, we all know that that might not be the case in our own institutions, but this is what's being reported nationally in our data. Okay, so what we do know is that people are, by and large, starting to look at different types of ways that they can get involved in the job market that don't necessarily have to be in the university. So they're looking more at all academic jobs, how we can get involved in continuing our research, but not continuing it necessarily on a tenure track line. We're seeing less tenure track lines created, but we're not seeing less tenure track lines in positions. Again, if we go back, there's still more tenure track lines available than there are students that we're graduating per year. So we're in a very healthy job market in communication. We're in a very healthy place for salaries across the board in humanities and in social sciences. So our job market's really healthy in communication. It's healthy for both undergraduates, it's healthy for our graduate students, and it only continues to grow. Every year, the number of job advertisements that we have available continues to grow when we look at this data annually in the national office. So I'm confident that you'll see this year that the advertisements continue to increase because we've had quite a bit this year that, you know, we kind of keep a tab as we go along, and it's looking really good this year as well. So So with that, I'm going to take some questions. I've talked for 14 minutes, and I'm supposed to stop talking at 15. So if you have any questions, let me know. If you want me to back up and go through any of these slides with you, I'd be happy to do that. I know that's a lot of data to throw at you, a lot of figures. So if you have any questions or you want me to back up, then let's do that now.
So there were some industries that you listed, and a lot of them seem pretty healthcom heavy. Are there any other industries that are hiring PhDs, or is there still a perception that PhDs for industry are overqualified?
In who we've talked to, we've not seen an idea that they're overqualified. What we do see is that they want the skills that we bring. I think what you're seeing as far as the health comm positions is that there's just a bigger boom in health-related fields right now. There's also, you know, like the PhD jobs also go through, you know, highs and lows. So 1 year you'll see org comm jobs get big. The next year it's health comm jobs. The next year it's PR jobs. And I think we're seeing that with what undergraduates are experiencing as well. So I think right now we're seeing health grow because it's an industry that's finally getting some oomph. And I think that has to do with policy at the government level. I don't know what will happen with that now. but, you know, that you don't know. So I think that that's how I would sum that up. I don't think that it's because they're overqualified for other positions, because we still see people looking for communication majors in other fields, particularly PR, and also digital communication. Social media managers are getting big, and they're looking for communication managers or communication degrees. So I think that the skills that they bring are obviously, and we know that they're applicable to everything, but I think people are starting to finally get a grasp on that.
Hello, thank you for your presentation. Because the field is so heavily composed of women, I'm curious to know what the breakdown of that salary information is by race and gender. If you have any stats on that.
I do have those stats. I do not have them with me right now, but I can get them to you if you would like me to. Yep.
When you say communication program, do you include those media program or journalism, something like that? And also the other question I have is similar to that, but it's not just gender and race, but whether there's the field difference because of what the job market maybe overall is good, but it's only skewed towards certain fields. So for other fields, maybe not that good, so that's why there's still people unemployed. So did you account those factors as well? I mean, for the overall job market seems good, but maybe it's skewed towards certain fields, subfields, like maybe PR or something. So other fields may be very tight in terms of job market or even none. So those type of situation, how do we account that especially is actually end up people being employed?
For undergraduates, we really can't tell you much about where they're going because it's such a large and broad field that we can't get that information unless schools provide it. So, and if we don't have that information, we can't tell you if it's skewing a certain way. I can tell you that from national data trends tell you that it doesn't skew a particular way. When they list jobs for communication majors and what they're more likely to do, they're more likely to be jobs that we would expect of communication majors, things like reporting and things that are like social media managers and marketing managers. So at times it's, you know, for me who I teach PR courses, I don't look at PR and marketing the same way. So for me, I see communication majors going into marketing and I say, that's really not the best use of their skill set all the time. But they're still getting jobs there. So for business majors, for instance, it might be that they think that it's being skewed toward communication majors. You know, I think it's all just dependent on what the skill set is that that organization might be looking for. But no national trend says that it skews one way or another. At the PhD level, as far as concentrations maybe go, like interpersonal org, those change every year. So I can tell you, we do have the data on what is the most commonly requested or asked for on the job market that year. I have all of that information. I actually have it with me, and I can give you that information. I think last year it was mass media that were the most common on the advertisements. In the communication program, what we consider communication programs did not at that time include journalism programs. It only included communication programs. If they included media in their communication PhD, then that was fine. But if they had an actual school of journalism, it was not included here.
Your data suggests that there's an increase in the job market and that there are enough jobs. However, I've been told by quite a few people that that's not the case, that people are retiring, but they're not necessarily opening up the line. So I'm receiving conflicting viewpoints on this. Why is that the case?
I don't know. I really can't give you that information. Anecdotally, I can tell you I've been told the same thing. When I was out on the market myself in 2010, It was that people weren't retiring, and therefore you couldn't get a job. Even though the jobs were out there, nobody was actually going to hire the job out, or they expected the job to be available, so they put it on the market, but then nobody retired. So I'm not sure about that. I know that the jobs are available. We can only report on what's available and what's actually posted. So these are jobs that are posted on CritNet. These are jobs that are posted on our job target database. So the ones that you'll see if you go to CritNet or if you go online to the NatCom website. Whether those jobs actually make, I can't speak to. So if somebody doesn't retire, if somebody retires and they don't get that line back, I can't speak to that. I do know that it has been suggested to me that it is the case that people are leaving their expecting lines and they're not getting them back. I know that that was the situation where I was previously. We lost a couple lines, we didn't get them back. So I expect that we weren't alone in that situation.
Recently I was filling out an online job application for an assistant professor of communication position, and I thought I was prepared, but I was stunned when one of the blanks said, "What is the minimum salary you would accept?" What should I have done? Should I have said a dollar amount, or should I have said negotiable?
I think that's a good question for discussion, actually. I hadn't run into that situation until last year when somebody asked that question, and I've talked to more people about this in all academic careers than I have in institutional careers, because I haven't seen that as often in the institution, people asking what your desired salary would be. I've been asked in institutions what your previous salary was, if you're moving from institution to institution. But I'm seeing that more often if you're in an alt academic career and it's a research position, what your desired salary is. So have any of you had that same experience? Right, okay. have you had that same experience where you've been, yeah? What did you do, if you don't mind telling us? I think what I would probably do in that situation, and perhaps it's not the right thing, but I would look up and see what the average salaries are in that area. And yeah, then I think that's what I would have done. I would find out what the average salary is in that area and find out what the cost of living is in that area. I mean, there are lots of cost of living calculators that will tell you, if I make this here, then I need to make that there. So I think in that situation, you have to figure out what you need to survive and make that dollar amount clear. If they're asking that question, that I think I would be very clear with them up front. Oh, really? Oh. I don't know how I feel about that question. Did you have a question? All right, are there any other questions? You want to know where it is? We update it yearly. We do the jobs report yearly. We've just started doing it on an academic year basis. So you'll start seeing it at the end of an academic year, whereas opposed before we were doing it calendar year, so you would see it at the beginning of the year. Now you'll start seeing it probably in September. And it's under the data about the discipline part of the website. And we'll be getting a new website, of course, as you've probably heard, in hopefully December. So it will still be in the data about the discipline section. And if you want, you can go to that section, and there's tons of information about jobs, about the PhDs and where they're going, about who's on the market, how many people are on the market, about what the job field looks like. We've got information about the value of the communication degree so that you can use that for your undergraduates. So there's information both for you in the market, and then there's information both, you know, also for your undergraduates that are going to be on the market as well. So there's lots of that information in the data about the discipline section on the website.
So I'm I'm changing careers, and I'm in my master's program, and I'm teaching. I'm wanting to teach when I'm done. What I've been told is that the most likely place to get a job with a master's degree to teach is at a community college, because less colleges and universities desire people, they want their doctorate. So can you tell me trends for a master's level graduates as compared to doctorate? I've got about 5 weeks to decide if I want to do my doctorate. I put it off. What the trends are for employment after you get a master's degree compared to the PhD programs?
I wish I could tell you more about masters. We don't have a lot of information on masters only. We have some information on undergraduates. It's not easy to get information on undergraduates. It's really easy to get information on doctorate students because there's not as many. But there's a ton of master's students, so it's really hard to track them and see where they go. But it's not been the case that master's students aren't getting hired. I sat in a panel yesterday where they were talking about how they're having to increase the number of people who are teaching their master's students the education courses so that they can teach in community colleges. So that was positive, I thought, for people who were getting their master's degrees. I'm not sure what the trend overall is for that. Are you standing there telling me it's time to stop talking? Okay. Thank you so much for coming. I appreciate it.